safer. They can easily put that block in towards center line, just like you said. It kind of nullifies that building path on that side, especially since you know that things got changed around. There is no Bolt Hawk, there is no Talon Pistol, so teams are going to have to add an extra bit of depth to their strategy or just kind of use those utilities wisely. So talking about that overhead map, you see the strategy, COG team, Rebel, in this situation, they're actually not going for their advantage high ground. They're going ahead and they're trying to attack B, and this is exactly why you don't do that, Blaze. You give up the advantage to PK, they now have the high ground, and they immediately take advantage. You don't want to go ahead and give away your only advantage on the map early on.
When it comes down to that B hill, the top spawn, which was the swarm squad this time around, and the better advantage, the quick rotation. Can number two make it in time? He shall not. Beautiful initial out of PK. They matched the numbers off the initial. It was a 2-3 from both squads. 3v3 fight at B, 2v2 fight up top between the home hills. PK won the initial. Great rotation for the quick domination. Now let's see what's going to happen on the weapon placement.
To say, now it's going to be PK's turn. Smoke, flash, depending on what they want. Since it's right there, I'm going to say flash. Yes, they usually put the incense directly onto the hill. So that way, in rotation towards E on the second half, it's kind of there. It's a little bit closer towards the hill. It's easier to get into play right away. But on the other side of things, though, Blaze, it's already interesting. You already see difference in strategy. One team trying to build towards that shock early on, while on the other side of things, Rebel trying to build towards those incendiary grenades. That's going to be the difference in rounds as this one progresses.
Yeah, this will cause a mismatch here when we see the weapon placements progress later on. We'll break that down to you for you later. Now, PK off this time, they decided to send most of their lumbers up top at C. They did not want to make the same mistake their opponents made against them. So they're going to give up their home hill down low to keep pressure on the top end of the map. And this is what we talked about earlier, it being a game of rotations here. And both these squads kind of wolfpacking until they can find that prime opportunity to break off towards the center of the map and flank their opponent. Frank doing a good job utilizing that one flash that he had to hold off PK. Pushes himself in the corner, but he finds a kill. Couldn't get the quick turnaround and use that Mi shield to square up in another engagement. PK gets those two. They'll be able to keep rotating towards B, but on the other end of the map, we're going to get Rebel spawning up. And that's why PK kept rotating. They knew Rebel was going to spawn. They were in enemy territory. They said, we cannot stay here. They felt Rebel kind of breathing down their backs off the respawn. And now they're going to get set up at B.
And because of the way this map plays, we talked about counterclockwise, clockwise rotations around the circle, not really touching the middle. When a team or player does get eliminated, the opposite team, when they rotate through spawn, have to be very careful and have to be sure of their timing. But here comes the push from Rebel, trying to dominate this positioning. This is the neutral. They do need a decap if they want to keep this lead intact, and it is going to come through in... Oh, I said it a little bit too soon. It's actually going to take over. They're unable to get that decap. Talk about corners. Identives keeping adverse guessing, not letting that decap come easy. But that is going to be the bait they needed as Demon takes out Identity. The crack's going to fall, but Demon is going to keep it going. Getting that down on Raver. Reflame and Cardia backing him up as well. Summons, though, for PK. Getting a double kill for his squad. Find the time that is needed. And that's going to be a triple kill. Summons putting the team on his back in this exchange.
And Reflame put his team on his back as well. Winning a key 1v1 against Desonite at C, and he got the decap at A. That brought back multiple members of PK and going to give his team an opportunity to get set up at B and fight it once again while the score is still close. Now, let's see if Rebel make the same mistakes they did last time around. Or we'll see if PK's defense is as strong as it was before. I like that one a little bit better because Rebel, no matter what they threw at PK, they just had every angle locked down. This time around, Cardi and Crack try to burst their way through the front, but Summons is still here. And he was the deciding factor last time around. But this time, he gives his teammate a 1v1, and Monkeys capitalizes.
And Monkeys, just time and time again, just a slang powerhouse. So always try to watch him, try to implement it into my game as Reflame pushing up on Identives. They need this break. Identives actually getting flanked. So at this point, he just needs to stay alive, possibly get a trade. He does get taken down. Reflame. He's going to put that man 6 feet deep, but the score is just out of reach. Two Hills still racking up points. Pittsburgh Knights in 3 minutes and 8 seconds in round number two is going to take that one and lead 2-0 over Rebel. And I got to ask you, Blaze, so far from what you've seen out of these past two rounds, what is Rebel doing wrong and what do they need to change?
So what Rebel did wrong these last two, round number one is that they went to go match PK down low and hit that. disadvantage when it came down to giving up PK that they had the height advantage off spawn. Now, Rebel could have went up top and took their numbers, but they chose the match. And we just watched PK play that same fight, and they came out victorious. So I can't really fault them for that. They just lost their gunfights. This last round, they lost the gunfights, and they had the more advantageous position. And they lost two team fights, and they pretty much, it was not putting any more respawns into this round. It was hard fought. But now Rebel needs to make an adjustment here. And maybe this time around, instead of going for B, they send their numbers up top C and run a similar strategy to PK. But if I know PK, PK will match that, okay?
Do this to me.
PK will match that strategy, and they're going to send four players up top as well towards helicopter.
What do you think it is?
I don't think it's... It's crack.
He fell through the cracks.
He did. He may. We'll try to get him pulled back into the lobby here soon, folks. And we'll see what strategy both these teams will be running out. But so far, no good for PK with them having this 2-0 lead here. Now, Jacob, you asked me what I thought was going wrong. What did you think was going wrong?
Rebel, I mean, it kind of is something I've been saying through the qualification process, even till now. It's just the inconsistencies from this squad is just so blaring. One day they're looking like one of the top teams in Gears Esports. The next day they're just getting run through by some of these teams that might not necessarily be the top. So now you bring that sort of factor in going against one of the best teams in the game, ranked number one right now in Gears Esports, undefeated. You're going to run into some speed bumps. You're going to run into some hiccups. So you have to try to play as consistent as possible. And going up against a team like PK, like I said, that's going to be so hard. You got to make sure that if you do make a mistake, you don't harp on it. If you do get caught out of position, you can't get flustered. And then going through on offensive side of strategies, you need to make sure you be sure of yourself. We already see the difference in weapon placements being placed down. If it does get out of hand, it's already 2-0. Possibly if they lose this next round, you got to start thinking about changing up the fight, using a big power weapon like a drop shot, a torque roll, even a boom shot to do that, to change up those fights. So it's going to be real interesting to see if Rebel can bounce back, if they start to begin to show some life, because right now I'm just not convinced.
Yeah, still early on in this one. And we'll see if these last two rounds of the half, Rebel can do just that. You know, when it comes down to the battle between both these squads, it's always a close one. It's usually never decided until about the last two rounds. And we get, you know, PK gathering as much intel as they can throughout these rounds. Both these squads gathering intel on each other to be able to have that perfect strategy here towards the back end of that map. But we're just getting this player back into the lobby. Had a slight disconnection from servers. Once he get in here and everybody gets all connected, we'll have this one all set up and ready to go. We appreciate you guys for all of your patience, but it's been a fantastic night of Gears of War so far. You disconnects here and there, but when the action is going, it has delivered. Do you agree?
It definitely has delivered. Even some of those mollywopping matches where you see a 5-0 in those individual rounds, especially kind of knowing the caliber players that they're up against. I'm going to go ahead and reference UIU versus Carnage Gaming, a team that has won the majority of championships in recent years going up against Carnage, who's a new team. And that 5-0 was still kind of exciting in some aspects, just seeing players really make a name for themselves, step up to the plate and solidify that victory. A team that had fell short time and time again, unable to execute rounds. To me, it was almost exciting to watch. It was like a breath of fresh air, realizing that it's just not one team dominating the scene anymore. And honestly, this season is a perfect example of that. And it's something, as a fan of Gears Esports, I like to watch some of these matches, but it almost gets stale watching the same team dominate. So this season, probably one of my favorites by far.
I agree with you on that one. I think it's one of my favorites by far as well, just based off how close the competition has been. The only thing that can make it better is if we were all on land making this thing happen. And we got back to our old rotations of event to event, flying around. And, you know, I will say that I am happy that we were able to get at least Mexico City out the way before we got the COVID lockdowns of the last season. It was great timing, because a week earlier, we don't get that awesome event. And it was a good note to end on until everything got picked back up once again, whenever that day may come. But till then, I feel like we've made some good adjustments, being able to bring Gears Esports online and keep bringing this action to you guys at home so you guys don't miss out on anything. And so much love to all our players who are competing in the league, because these guys have been putting on a show despite all the difficulties it has been with them playing online.
And I honestly love how you mentioned that Mexico City event for many reasons. I'm a big fan of food, so that's going to be reason number one. The amount of food we ate, and I know you personally, Blaze, we were sitting at a couple of those tables together, eating up about 10 tacos each, something
well,
like that.
Well, about minimal.
But obviously, if you look at that event as a fan of Gears Esports, that Sunday was probably one of the best Sundays on land that I have been able to be a part of in a long time. That Dynasty UIU squad falling to Fire and Ice, forcing that roster change. You see Hive really go up against the best of the best. Unfortunately, they fell short, but that match was spectacular. PK forcing
short.
That round number five, or game number five, taking that one on the other side of the bracket. I do believe it was Reciprocity versus FNI. Reciprocity, I do believe, 2-0'd that one, but it was still close. It was very exciting for the fans.
Rated R.
That grand final. Oh, even Rated R.
Rated R versus Reciprocity was a good
Marsh
one.
Return of Marsh was actually fantastic. He bringing his team right back to the top eight. You got to see what Marsh does for teams, not necessarily within footage or you know, VOD or voices, but within placements. Anytime he's on one of these rosters, he brings them immediately towards the top eight. But then that grand finals, Blaze, between PK and Reciprocity went down to the wire. And one of my favorite moments was after it, right? Reciprocity's winning the event. You got all of them on stage, ready to take the crowd, but the crowd is just booing them. That's not my favorite moment, even though, you know, one of them. The crowd is just going wild. But Desenide, all the respect in the world to that man, Desenide, takes the mic and demands respect from the crowd, saying, hey, we might not have won today, but these guys played their hearts out just like we did, so they deserve the same respect we do. And so even though you're looking from the outside in, might not be a part of the Gears Esports scene, but you guys need to know we are a family, we stick together, and we support each other through thick and thin.
It was no better time for an event like that one. PK, the two series that they won to make it to the finals, they were down 2-1, down 4-2 in map number four against Hive. They forced them map five, get themselves to the grand finals, and then they were down 2-0 against Rec. And then they had to win two maps in a row to force the last map in the finals to possibly win it. And they were showmen. They were showmen. They put on a show for the fans and the crowd, getting us to the furthest point in which we couldn't get in at that event. And in hindsight, it worked out because it was the last one. So, you know, and shout out to all the Latium fans out there in Mexico, because when we ever get an event out there, you guys show us so much love coming down from the States. And you guys are real Gears of War fans. And I haven't seen passion like what you guys have in years. Okay. Maybe not ever. So it's always a pleasure. Okay. It's always a pleasure. And as you see, LATAM teams, they are dominating our pro league as well.
And what I also like too is I'm talking to a lot of the crowd. A lot of them at the time, they don't care about the merch. They don't care about it being name brand. They'll support their favorite player, even if they have to make the stuff themselves. And you're going through, spotting some of those things. Awesome. You know, I'm talking to the fans. I'm talking to people who support their teams. And like just like you said, that support, that passion, not only for the scene, but supporting their own is the biggest thing. It didn't matter who was up on that stage for grand finals. The crowd blew the roof off that place. Fortunately, it was the team that we're showcasing here today. And honestly, it was kind of half and half, to be honest, because half of that Rebel roster was there on that same stage.
Yes, they were. And so, you know, well, half the Fire Knife's roster now, I want to say, was on that stage, because that's the Chaos and Sleeper combo that was with them. You know, it's easy, because I want to say they were probably on Rebel at one point, too, as well.
They're on every team at one point.
The way, you know, especially everybody comes together, and they shift teams, and they shift player combinations around there in a region to make the best teams that they possibly can. And I love the ones in which we got, because even with players moving around a bunch, I feel like we got the three best. I feel like we got the three best teams out of Latin America with the players that were the top players we had of last season. And we've gotten two newer squads out of Apricity and Carnage as well, with their formations, with their formation into the league. Also with Elevate, yeah. We got three more. We got three more great teams added into the league.
And what's great, too, is there's always one team that just makes noise when they qualify for the Pro League. Vanquish did it their first time around. It was Noble last time when they went ahead and added Toady to that roster. And now Carnage Gaming just making up for missed opportunities of the past. They said, not no more. We're here, and we're here to stay, especially with that big win over UIU. So now when we go back to this match, even though that's not necessarily a North American team, Rebel is going to look to topple over the top dogs.
All right, folks, we are back into the lobby. It is reset from the ground up to the top. Now, we get to see our second selection of weapon placements, and each squad is going to respectfully build up their grenade. Now, this weapon tree is going to be different on both of those. Those incendiary grenades can go to frags. That shot can go to an M-bar. We saw PK do that last time they played Rebel in a difficult situation, and Identis is just popping off with that M-bar. To make some clutch plays with that drop shot down low a tank. We'll see how they evolve as this map progresses. Kicking this one off, we did see Rebel send majority of their players up top like I did foresee. Now, the two players down low, they're going to have to stop this rotation to their home hill. But luckily, PK got to go up a set of stairs. So a slight height advantage for Rebel. Demon trying to get a shot off his left hand, but he may have overstayed his welcome. And Rebel's getting a little bit flustered here, but reinforcements are going to come through. And Avers has his lance route, focus firing at that doorway.
Oh, this is a real trick play coming through the smoke. Demon catching people off guard, able to get that first elimination. Didn't see the other one run away, so he's kind of waiting there, but he's going to take his time, get his angles. But Raver, we've seen him save games before, getting that big elimination, buying time. Because look at Blaze on the other side of the maps. Two hills once again in favor of the Pittsburgh Knights. But the rotations from both Reflame and Cardia is going to put a stoppage to that B hill. But look at on the top side, rotations all around. We talk about Vaskar is a fully rotation-based map. Pittsburgh Knights, knowing that rotation is going over to the neutral hill, wasting no time after capturing their own. But I do think Desenide might have went ahead by himself, but he actually gets that elimination on Adverse. Gets the meat shield as well. They're funneling cracked down, possibly into more team fire.
Now, bit of a misfire right there. But even though the down came through, the revives are there as well. So PK with the two-man advantage currently, they are able to lock down their opponent's home hill. They got an A, they got a C. They see that Rebel is possibly trying to push through this B hill, but they're going to be able to regain control, and they're just going to give up A, slow it down a bit. They say, hey, you guys can have your home hill back. We got the remaining hills. Ultimately, Rebel is going to try to force PK. PK is going to try to force Rebel down low to B, but Rebel's not taking that bait. They want this hill up top at C, and they're doing a good job on a retake. The focus fire is there, but PK's defense with this shot grenade may be too much now.
But that player Desenide rolling in towards the center. Talk about using the map. He actually gets downed out by Demon. Picks up that kill. Another player from PK giving up that hill, rolling towards the middle. This is so close. Rebel with a decap and a capture. They can easily come back, gain the lead towards their side. And that's going to be huge towards the very ending portions of the game. So you already see three members, both Raver, I think Identifs and Monkeys, MVP style players, making that push towards the other side of the map. They absolutely need this. Less than 10 seconds left. Rebel will gain the lead back.
Now Rebel fighting hard. They need to win this fight on top of the A hill. It's such a close round. With those kills, they will be able to regain control of A. Summons gets taken out quickly. Now let's take note that Demon is on his last respawn. And you know that when you play PK, you can't put yourself in a difficult position when it comes down to respawns against them. But luckily enough for Rebel, they do lock this round in the books. That was a must win for them. Now they need to be very careful as they go into round number four, with the respawn timers being the highest. That means more action. Some fights are going to kick off earlier, more frequently, and Demon needs to play his life. He's got to be careful about how he engages in them. The reason why he is so low in respawns and why we highlighted him in a pre-show is because the fact he is one of their main slayers, but PK got his number right now.
Sometimes being that main slayer means some maps, some rounds, you might be a double-edged sword. It's all about opportunity and capitalizing on it. Right now, Demon thinks he sees an open window, but it's actually him running into a screen door, which is the Pittsburgh Knights. I've seen that happen one too many times, and I'm seeing it happen here yet again with Demon. But I would say luckily for him, he's picking up some of these big eliminations. He's opening up some holes, but as a team, they're not going ahead of PC. Yeah, that was a big instant from downtown. I've seen that happen with a shot grenade. I don't like it with an instant. You're putting all risk, no big reward if it misses.
The reward came in the B Hill capture. They were able to force those players outside the back tank and get them scared off. Now, PK, they've shifted most of their forces at C. Rebel, they backed up to defend their home hill. And now they got enough players to be able to defend B as well. Let's see if Rebel will be able to defend this, but PK pushes right through, and I did say some cojones the way he pushed through that smoke for a back A off his left hand to get that kill. But his team, they got the kill. Now, Rebel's rotation down low, Jacob. It's a good one.
Wow. Rotation coming through all towards the top half of the map. A is not being capped up. We're still in the early portions of the game as well. This is the last round of the half. Respawn timers would be at their utmost shortest, so it's going to be spawn after spawn after spawn if these players continue to eliminate each other off the map. That's going to be a big down coming through from Raver, but that is even better positioning change coming through from Raver, realizing, hey, my teammates might be able to pick up the down. If not, I'll be able to get damage for them to pick it up myself. And inch by inch, it does look like PK is just pushing. They're being aggressive. They're up 2-1, and they want to make it 3-1.
Number 9, that's going to be Monkeys. He's down in the corner. The lances from Rebel is a little bit too much for PK at this moment, so they have to back up another tier. But Demon, able to get some kills cleaned up. Raver, he's able to push through, take out Krakenite. Dents has found one as well. So, currently, 4v4 on the map. Party are taking out Raver now. With this happening, Jacob, Rebel has pressed PK back far enough. But they would just disengage from this fight, but they don't disengage in time because they already got the two hills in which they needed. Monkeys won a big fight down low on top of B, which should put that hill in favor of PK. Now they have another 2v1 on top of C. Reflame needs to stay alive. Fight time for his teammates to get there. He gets rap-shotted, but was it enough? Rebel worked so hard in the earlier portions of this round to get this lead. Now, with this capture in, they win in a minute. They're looking for another heal, though.
They're hearing this fight. Demon needs to be careful. He's able to get the down. Saved by Adverse there. I was saying, he needs to be careful because he has no respawns remaining. Once he's out, he is out of this half. Forced to watch his team win the remainder of this one. But on the other side of things, Dezo is in the same boat. Decap coming through. Late shock. So the decap is going to go ahead and finish. But no capture coming through from Rebel. That's not good for the Knights. Now their path is blocked. And this is where I begin to say kills over hills. You need to make sure everything is neutralized. And then you can backtrack capping.
It's not over just yet. All five members in front of PK. And now they're about to get the only hill decap that Rebel has. Rebel are going to try to put three people on top of this B hill. If they don't get lost in individual fights, it should still be good to win this round. Currently getting a double capture on two separate hills. PK needs to play flawless. A's getting decapped. They have time to get B decapped, but not with that kill that Crack just acquired. Rebel gets this one all tied up 2-2. And what a crazy fight there.
That was a nice last-second effort to come through. Unfortunately, that insurmountable lead was just too much. Rebel doing a good job of piecing it back together round by round, all tied up to a piece. So I talk about those technical difficulties on the day, and usually there's one team using it to just take full advantage, rethink strategies, talk about what's going wrong, talk about what they need to fix, and adapting on the fly. And that's what really makes Champions Blaze, being able to adapt on the fly. Not every situation is going to go your way. You're going to be able to have to make something out of nothing in some of these scenarios.
All right, let's see who is the more adaptable squad as we are entering the second half of this matchup. And we said that it was going to go down in the wire when it comes down between these two teams here. So PK off rip here. They are going to have a more favorable advantage here on the top spawn of this map because of them having a height advantage at D and able to rotate towards F. Now, even with this rotation, Reflame shooting through the flames, able to hold back PK, gets another down on summons. His teammate is not going to be close enough to help. They're going to get an incendiary grenade on a preferable cover that a lot of players love to sit at. That means summons can't fully retreat there. He has to go into the open. Now PK can fluster, share multiple covers. The down's able to come out, but PK, they are able to hold their footing for now as Rebel taking angles and on the flank as well. 2v2 fight, Jacob.
This is where it's going to get big. Demon getting funneled back. Crack has to make a play. He does get the revive, but on different pages. Both players are going to go down nonetheless for the ninth live to fight another day.
But
on the other side of
the fight,
it's just it's not looking good. They're not able to extend past their own hill. They're only having one hill at a time, and that's good for Rebel because they had a little bit of coming back to do at one point or another. Now they're going to have the lead. They're going to build themselves a cushion. And if you ever look at the top side of the map, PK is giving up going after F, which is the home hill of Rebel. They're trying to overextend towards this neutral hill. First is the decap, but now they get funneled off the capture. Now they're going to have to fight for this every inch, to be exact.
Such slow rotations out of Rebel. Reflame and Cardia, they end up rotating to this hill, but that was 10 seconds after they won the team fight. They were looking at their opponents over at D, but you got to have that foresight to at least send one player back early and let the players off respawn fill in the gaps. But nonetheless, Rebel does have a lead currently. Now, they have a main advantage at E. They recognize that it's a mismatch down low, and I may have actually mistaken. It's a 3v3 fight here up top. PK had a guy hidden on the minimap I couldn't see. Raver gets a kill on Cardia, but ultimately, PK will win the up top fight at E. Down low, Rebel will win theirs. Now, what is going to be the next move here for Rebel? Well, they're going to try to get E back and decap their opponent's home hill in the process. And that's exactly what may be happening here.
All about grabbing these inches, turning them into more. Pittsburgh Knights, a team that's notorious for doing that, but Rebel is showing that they have a high skill ceiling, that potential is there for this squad. They get that decap on the neutral hill. They're going to get the capture as well. Adverse getting a little bit ahead of himself, but the reinforcements are there. Revive coming through from Crack. The lead is still going to be intact for Rebels, so the Pittsburgh Knights are going to have to make a defensive stop somewhere because we know the rotations are going to come through from Rebel, so it's all about a stoppage for the Pittsburgh Knights.
All right, here we go. PK trying to hold off their home hill from this rebellion. They're gonna be able to pick up multiple kills here and officially wipe the whole squad. One member left, it's Adverse. He's gone now. Little love tap on his own squad mate. It was a close engagement, but the Knights, they hold their footing. They're gonna lock round number 5 in the books, man. Rebel hit that one. They looked good for a while. They had it locked in, but PK was able to beat them off the rotations and kind of bait them into an unfavorable fight on top of their home hill, and that's where they want it.
Towards your home hill, away from the home hill. Both these teams have two different strategies kind of going into this series. You can almost see it in terms of their weapon placements. They have the same overall idea, but priority and what's important is what's going to be different. You see the extra bit of utility in the hands of the Pittsburgh Knights. On the other side of things, they're going to have that instant time down to every 60 seconds. And you know, I say it doesn't play a huge role on this initial, but every minute having an extra kill lethal weapon is going to be huge, especially for this region. They actually specialize in those instants for a very long time.
All right, here we go. Now, towards the bottom portion of the map, the Pittsburgh Knights, they're going to go choose to play for this D-Hill on the other end. And they quickly recognized their advantage and was able to take out Adverse. But Rebel, they're able to split their numbers 2-2. They won their fight up top with their numbers, and they only need two players to really defend D since it's on top of a hill. And that's going to be Pittsburgh Knights having to go up those stairs. So just two lances on a focus fire was enough to force the rotation back for the Knights. Now, let's see how they want to play it as we're getting geared up for a 3v3 fight down low and a 2v2 fight up top. Identis hits one back A there. He gets support from his teammate to help pick up both kills. And Adverse, can he get away? He cannot. The Lancer fire from Monkey's just proven to be a little bit too much as the Knights are able to cap up D.
That's going to be huge. Talk about the Knights being able to cap up D. They're down 30 points. This is how you get back into this one. Two hills under their control. And Rebels barely fighting for one. Demon gets downed out. Cardia taking a lot of damage. He actually gets downed as well. Demon leaves him to die. And I almost think you gotta do it, but he actually dies as well. So he meets the same fate as one of his brethren. But Rebel on the other side of the map knows they have to pick it up for their team. One elimination going down. Crack and others rotating towards this F hill. It's gonna be huge, but the Pittsburgh Knights see it coming. Three members from Rebel now matching up against three members of the Knights. Make that four as Identis spawns into the game and a fourth even rotates from Rebel. So rotations all around. Both of these teams, offense meets defense.
Now, PK, as they are fighting for their home hill, 4v4 fight. They got a, it's also a 1v1 fight at D. Now, Crack is able to help focus fire with his teammates. They get one down. And now, since they are able to clear out the spawn of PK, do they want to chase? Do they want to hold what they got? They choose to chase, but PK was waiting for him. They said, we're not going to run for too long here. We just want to get a little cover. Big playback Crack, but in the end, this F hill will be lost. And the home hill was lost up top. Who is that? That's Destinite. Won a 1v2 on top of D to get the hill for his team.
And here, all he has to do is stay alive. He did his job. He wasted all the time in the world. And he's going to get a free flank on Reflame. And while this is going down, instead of going for those shots, he's just trying to keep wasting Cardia and Demon's time. Two hills continuing being in the favor of the Pittsburgh Knights. They came back from that deficit, and now they got themselves a 20-point lead. So now they just have to play great defense here, as actually this Monkey's the MVP, in my opinion, going to make a sneaky play towards the top side. So Desnite is going to be taken down. 3v2 is going to ensue on the home hill, but it's actually I said it 3v2, but Summon's putting that one on inside. It's actually coming down to a 2v2 on the other side of things. Monkeys wins the 1v1, and that 1v1 is going to be the biggest play because no one's sneaking past, no one's slipping through, no hills for you, Rebel, and Pittsburgh Knights solidify their fourth round and go on that point.
In that round, Adverse got on respawn watch. We were just in round number 2 of the second half, and that's out of a total of 5 rounds with the respawn timers getting lower, okay? So, Adverse, he got all the way down to 2 respawns, 2-1, and he just had to hold off. But when the fight started to go in the direction of Rebel, he spawned in. It looked good for a second, but Summon says, hold up, all right? It ain't that easy. Just picking them off one by one. Almost got the triple kill there. And PK holds on to the round. So Rebel, they're going to have to play even harder in this one to regain control of this map once again, Jacob. And it's gonna be a difficult one. They're going to have to win this first team fight off the start. It's going to go down at the tank where the drop shot is currently placed.
Seeing those sneaky instants come through from the angle that the Pittsburgh Knights are at over the top of the tank. They kind of gave up all that positioning in the world. Unfortunately, there's no hill directly located on the Talon, so I don't think that's going to be a play they're looking to go ahead and make. The flashes towards the backside. Sooner or later, the Pittsburgh Knights are going to have to make a play, are going to have to make a push. And I do believe this is going to be it. Desenide, he always seems to be the tip of the spear. Nice, well-placed instant in the drop of a hat, going ahead and taking him out. Drop shot trying to connect, unable to do so, but PK dominating this initial. They're going to get that big weapon and put themselves in a great position to get more.
They are in a beautiful position here. Now, they won't win this fight at F. Now, Summons is being sneaky again. This time, Rebel don't want to let him get away, but Summons, he'll do some rap shots, put some damage in as he's running away, but you got to be careful chasing him because he'll cut back on you quickly and go for the one shot and get back into the fight before you can blink. And now he has baited Rebel into a trap with his teammates. PK just Lancer down Hellfire. The Pride working together to take out Rebel. But speaking of fire, Reflame is going to turn it back up and deliver it right back at him. V-Heal getting pinched from multiple different directions. This is what Rebel can get some control back into the series. They need to win this fight now, but they're going to disengage. Half the players are here. Others are leaving. They don't have the numbers. PK got a leg up on them with the home heal. Rebel trying to save face. Keep two, but multiple players are looking a little flustered. Number 5 goes down mid-map trying to get away. 3 dies, and now PK will get an easy decap at F, and they got numbers at E.
You see it. Reflame coming off a respawn, immediately trying to help that neutral hill fight. The members of the Pittsburgh Knights have to be careful here if they're looking to rotate through spawn. Both Adverse and Crack, or now it's just Adverse, waiting for that perfect moment to spawn in. Anybody traveling through will get met with a spawn shield of beast. But Cardia, on the other hand, is without spawn shield, going to take out Desenide towards the top half of the map. Keep that hill in their control. Instant from downtown coming through from Reflame, not connecting with a direct hit, not even connecting with flames that are spreading over the cover, so it summons. He's going to continue to waste some time. He's actually going to get it down. He does not get the elimination, and he does get taken out. He was the last member alive. Pittsburgh Knight conceding this round away over to Rebel, but the score is still 4-3. They're still on series or map point here.
Must win round for Rebel. Must win. Now, looking at their response, they got to be careful. You know, they probably have maybe 1 or 2 max to give. Well, hell, They got to give them all, okay? They got to give them all, but they need to at least hope that they can win this round in one or two max, because PK, they are at map point. Now, looking at weapon selection, we will get a lock on incendiary nades, and it will be matched by their opponent, and PK knows that, or I do believe PK kicked that block off, but they know that, hey, you know what? We got to do this one. We got to block it off now. Actually, I take that back. That was Rebel who did the block, right? So my apologies. Rebel started the block, and they knew they had to block it now. So if they win this round, PK will not have a block remaining in the final round. So let's kick this one off. Yeah, it would be
big. I can understand wanting to end it here, but if you somehow don't and it does slip past, Rebel's going to have the same opportunity to end it on a round number 9. So the Pittsburgh Knights, you have to end it here. You have to close it out. And already we got a stalemate towards the top half of the map. Neither team wanting to make that mistake that will cost them this map.
All right. Now, the last shot grenade is going to get tossed here. And that's more of a shot grenade from Rebel to kind of stop the play from PK from progressing, I do believe. And the drop shot's still here. Raffers has a lock on it. We got four members of each squad. Number 5 and 0 are kind of mirror matching each other in the middle, seeing if one can cut away. It's a 1v1 up top, and it's a close 1v1. Maybe too close for comfort. Raver Demon, former teammates, I do believe, here from their Fire and Ice days. And Raver takes him out, locks in a heal. So now he has to go on a flank. Number 5 knows he has to guard. This is where Zero can make a play. 3 is trying to cover that lane, but PK knows the 3v2 is going to come at the front of the fight. And they're going to try to take it now, but Reflame and Adverse hold them off with a team kill coming through. And Identis, Rebel gets the elimination victory, and they get this one all tied up. Almost. One player spawns in. He holds them off. Can Summons do what he needs to buy his team some time?
Tables are turning right now. Talk about that lock playing a big role for the Knights. Unable to execute when it matters most. They still have a little bit of a lead, but how long would that lead last? A Monkey's gonna have to make a hero play. He's unable to even get a touch. Four members standing side by side. Red Roses, Red Roses. Send Monkey right over. Unfortunately, he does not break the plane, and he gets swallowed up by Rebel. So now it's 4-4. Plays, and this is where we were talking about that lock is going to be big. So now an opportunity for Knights to close out the map is no more, and that opportunity switches over to Rebel if they can go ahead and lock it down. But I gotta ask you, do you lock down the incendiary or do you lock down the shock?
Oh no, nobody has the lock. Only one play on both. They used it the last
round.
So the locks are off. Oh man, they may have made the mistake because we saw it last week. Give Identis an M bar. Give them that end bar with the height advantage. Watching,
did they do it?
Yeah, they do it. Did Rebel not do the VOD last week? Instead,
they took
the incendiary every 60 seconds, but this is the exact way this layout went down in Emergence Day.
Three
shots. So, let's see what happens.
Oh, no. It's a collateral.
Drop a beat. Oh!
That's a collateral!
Through the smoke! You can't give him the M bar, folks! He got 2 shots left. He's gonna connect with a body shot. His teammates got the drop shot. Look at the connect one as they transition through the middle of the map. He got marks on multiple players. He is calling the shots from the top tower. He says, "Don't worry, guys, I got your back." And he's gonna see Demon on the flank as well. So, PK with map control. Jacob, what a start.
What a start indeed. And just hearing that sound of the M bar charge up, you have to be careful. You have to be worried, especially if you have just a little bit of damage on you. It will get a stun. It will get a kill just like that with the drop shot as well. Need to be careful. Monkey's able to get one, and he's keeping Rebels on their toes, not letting them get anything. But there goes a quick elimination. He's going for that second one as well. That would have been a great trade. He was able to get it off and dies, but instead he gets the reinforcements needed. And Identif does it again. 3 shots. 3 kills. One of them was a collateral, though. Reflame trying to fight back with every fiber of his being. This is round number 9, map number 1. This sets the pace for the rest of this series. And Adverse trying to do everything he can to keep his team in this game after that demoralizing start by Identis.
All right, so he was able to get his incendiary grenade. His teammates have F locked in. That's a big kill for Summons to get tucked away in a corner, dodge 2 nades. His teammates get a clean 2v2 fight in the front, but a little support towards the back. PK shall get the F heal. Now, Adverse, I don't believe that he has that incendiary grenade any longer. Rebel, their respawns are so low. Reflame has zero. PK has plenty to work with, so PK want to win this one off 2-1. They just want to keep these fights scrappy, stay in the mix. And Demons and Demons, that was a big kill on Summons, actually. One player, PK, trapped, two trapped in the trenches. And Rebel, they capitalize. Dezo can't stay alive. He goes down. Drop shot picked up by Rebel. It's anyone's game, Jacob.
First one going out. Unable to connect. You need to be careful. Exactly that. Nerves. Demon's a little bit nervous, getting a little bit ahead of himself, firing that shot off. And the thing is, even if he does pick up a kill, there's still two other members there. So it wasn't even the most smart play to come through. But M-Bar, I do believe, is going to be up. You already see a player backtracking for it and trying to set up this defensive stop. Both Summits, I do believe, Monkeys. But Monkeys goes through. I don't know if he got taken out. Make short work of him. Adverse does get the down on Summons, but he's not able to clean it up. Big stop by Monkeys, and he goes against the revive first, making sure his teammate does not bleed out. 202, 188. Both of these teams are capping up a hill. So if this goes one hill, each Pittsburgh Knights will solidify this victory. Round number 9 and take back number 1.
No matter if you're in LATAM or NA and what you're watching, this is a chaotic moment in time here as it is all tied up in the final moments of this one. The flank comes through for Rebel. They get the decap at B. They don't win a fight up top. And PK, they got two heals locked in. And even though Rebel was able to fight back just a bit, PK off the back of their team captain, Identis, that initial with the M-Bar, set them up for victory in this map. What a victory for them. They close out map number 1, 5-4. And what a great series we got here. It's going to be a long night.
Definitely is. Hard-fought battles, inch by inch. The Knights probably thought that one's going to be a little bit easier, but that's why we played these matches out. Blaze Rebel answering the call. Even though it wasn't a victory, they went right down to the wire. A team that I at least thought was a little bit too inconsistent are beginning to slowly but surely prove me wrong. Big win for the Pittsburgh Knights, gaining that momentum. So map number 2 on Forge is going to be very, very interesting because we already seen these two teams go the distance. So it's just a matter about what strategies you employ on Forge.
Yeah, that's what it's going to come down to. I think that Forge is going to be just as close as this map number 1 is was as well. But you know, you got to give props to both these squads. PK is a dominant Vanguard team, but Rebel, man, I love the rotations in which they were making on this map, how they were able to counteract PK, the different initials that we saw to both teams, having to respect the height advantages in several different areas of this map. Both these squads slowing it down, not trying to play for too much, but just enough for their team to get an advantage that can get them a victory based off of time here. And, you know, we saw some rounds where we thought that one team definitely had it, but one squad comes out with elimination domination to really turn the tables and get us to what we saw in this awesome round number 9.
And that, to me, that really separates men from the boys. You see it time and time again. There were some mistakes being thrown away. You saw early on, I want to say it was maybe that last round or maybe the one prior, Demon just throwing those drop shots way past the target, not really taking his time. We talk about how nervous they can be. And a massive collateral, though, on the tiebreaker round from Identis through the smoke. And even though it was smoke, though, you got to give all the credit in the world to his team. That crossfire from the Knights was huge to get that down in the first place. And so you working as a complete unit are the Pittsburgh Knights, and they are still undefeated here in our Pro League.
Man, yes, they are. This is the final round here, final engagement, one off time, ultimately in the end. Looking back at this one, we got three dominations, we got three eliminations, and we got three rounds being one off time. We literally got everything in this map between these two squads. What a good map number 1. But it's not over just yet, folks. We do have to head on over to Forge, and I do believe if we go the distance, the final map will be District. Wrap yourselves in. Will this one be over in 2? Does anybody in chat want to change their prediction? Maybe? Maybe? Did Rebel convince you guys? You haven't you?
I've certainly done it before. I'm undefeated here on Gears Pro League with my predictions. That's how many times I've done it. But when it goes to the map, you got to think Pittsburgh Knights. That was their map pick on Vaskar.
It was
extremely close. Now Forge, you're going over to the Rebel map pick, and it's a little bit different. It's still very, very close quarter shotgun fights. You do get some inklings of Lancer play and some crosses, but it's about wolfpacking yet again as a unit. And because of the lack of rotations, I think that gives Rebel a little bit more of a chance to come back into this one. No players getting caught off guard. It's kind of like straightforward shotgun play towards the top side. So even though I think this is an opportunity for Rebel to come back into this one, I'm going to stick to my predictions. I think Pittsburgh Knights have an even bigger chance to close this one out, barring any surprising weapon placements, any surprising weapon drops. I got to think the Pittsburgh Knights will be able to close it out, but it's not going to be easy. It's not. I almost think that 51-49% matchup was this one.
Now, we can argue this, but to me, the hardest map for any team to perfect in our cycle has to be Forge, okay? That's how I feel. You know, Reactor could be one of them, but I just think that the squads just have not put the reps in it just yet. You know, just, and that's only because it's so new, right? It's one of the newest maps that we have, so we don't see it too often. But regardless of that, Forge is a difficult map to be great at. Now, on the flip end, Vaskar is a difficult map to be great at. That's the hardest map. I feel like these teams are, that's the hardest map for these teams to get great at. But on the flipping end, Forge, it's an easier map. You were saying it, Jacob. It's a little bit clear cut and dry. All the targets are in front of you. You win that initial fight up top in control tower. You can rotate down low, shoot down those other hills. Rather, if it's the middle at B, rotate, get those caps, get that trip cap domination. These squads have been playing a lot of Forge since Gears of War 4. The rotations have came a lot easier to this map. Even though it's recently added to our cycle, they've played it plenty of times before. And even on District is going to be another map that's a little bit simpler when it comes down to getting those trip cap dominations and those victories by elimination off the start, keeping your opponent in front of you, not letting them get behind you based off the geography and some of these hotspots on how the map is laid out. So with that being said, Rebel, these last two maps are looking good for them, because they know that they were able to keep up with PK's teamwork on Vaskar. It should only get easier for them on these next two.
Yep, and when you talk about certain elements that do come down to being key factors, is I don't necessarily know, and I'm almost looking at chat here for Ink to go ahead and correct me, or Deluxe, wherever he's at. Does Rebel have a top-tier coach? They have somebody kind of working with them, because last I heard, they didn't necessarily have that guy. And you overlook at the Pittsburgh Knights, you look at UIU, you look at our top teams in general, they have that sixth man. They have that guy kind of looking at the VOD, figuring out strategies, figuring out tendencies, so they don't have to do it. They can focus on their actual gameplay, focus on coming together as a team. So that way, when that VOD moment happens, that pre-practice happens, the coach kind of has it all laid out. You don't have to have somebody going ahead and staying up late, wasting some sleep, or maybe even thinking they're doing too much for the roster over everybody else. So that's why I'm going to be going ahead and looking at Rebel, at least towards that major does come around, if they are going to bring in that sixth man, if they are going to bring someone in to kind of help them. Because, I mean, there's a lot of good free agent coaches out there that could possibly fit the squad's needs. It's about finding the right one to kind of fill in that chemistry, fill in the voids that which they're lacking.
And I think you definitely need a good coach to be successful at this level, because just having that extra guy for help, if you can get it, get him. If you can find a great coach, make sure you pick him up, because when it comes down to finding these tendencies, that these little characteristics of each of these squads, if they had one in that last series, they would have knew Identis was putting an M-bar on that side of the map to fight for the drop where he had a height advantage. It was orchestrated from the beginning of the map, but they just cannot see it in that final moment. Because I know Demon would have wanted to have an M-bar. Somebody on that Rebel squad would have went toe-to-toe with him to try to hold back PK on picking up that drop shot. But let's see what adjustments both these squads will be making if we are blessed with getting another round number 9 in this Forge map.
I like the strategy already from PK. They faked up top play, sent most of their members to cut through middle, cut across. They're already disrupting the point lead coming through from Rebel. And now it's going to be up to Rebel to answer back. Not only do they have to strike down low, they have to strike in the middle, and they have to to get their home hill back, and they're going to do it a man down. Demon gets taken out. Identibs continues. That's going to be a big double kill. You see the rest of the squad teaming together. Close quarters combat. Wolf backing around. Triple cap domination sounding off for a moment. That first player eliminated. Reflame's going to spawn up and hopefully look to buy his team some time to play. This is that power position I'm always talking about. They're looking to bounce back on defense. Yep. They're going to take over on offense. Those pillars are so important.
Oh, nice revive for Reflame, but he's not going to have another teammate with him. At least he was able to take one to the grave. Brought time for Adverse, and his teammate revives him, and he gets another one off. Teammate blocks his shot, but ultimately, Reflame, with his back against the wall, he brought his team enough time to stay in this one.
Do it to him. But, don't do it to him.
Oh, he hits the wrap shot, but it was not enough. Monkeys is still there. And in the back lines, he wipes the remaining members there of Rebel. And PK, they strike first in round number one. All right, let's see what's going to happen here going into the next. Weapon placement should be simple textbook. We may get some front spawn utility from both these squads because the front spawn fight and control tower is so important. And letting that guy to be able to throw his own nade just helps him out that much more.
And I do believe outside of the initial, in that round, there was not a single moment where Rebel had five people up as a unit. So the Pittsburgh Knights starting off hot in round number one, staggering the deaths, using the long respawn times to their advantage. So we go to the weapon selection screen. Utility. Utility has been the name of the game for Gears Esports since the season started, since the banning of the Boltok and the Talon pistol. So that extra bit of utility in the hands of, I do believe, Crack and Identibs is really going to play a big role. And I do believe both players are playing center. It's actually Identibs and Crack up top, actually.
All right. Identibs, he's going to dodge Demon's flank there for just a second. Desonite, he's going to get this player weak in the right corner. Identibs knows he can go for an easy back A. His second shot looked good, but in the mix, Demon couldn't get the turnaround to kill Identibs there up top. PK gets control. But Rebel won their fights down low. It's still a 1v1 for the trip cap domination. Identis is going to Lancer back Adverse to keep him off the hill. Rebel choosing not to play for it, but by Adverse not staying there, his teammate may have been left by himself over on a home hill. Ultimately, Adverse did buy his team time to lock themselves in a 2-to-1 hill setup. Identis is still alive, and he can make a play here. He's going to pinch from multiple angles. He will finally get taken out here. But in the end, his teammates were able to overextend from home hill to home hill, and he distracted those three players to keep his team with a little advantage. Well, they don't have the advantage just yet, but they're in a good spot to get it.
Reaver does get caught out. Trying to do too much, trying to be a little bit sneaky. Summons with the flank. He's able to get one. All hills even being decapped for just a few moments. Neither team really gaining any leads, but it is going to be Summons continuing to capture that B hill for a moment. He's actually got some opposition. That's going to be Demon going against him. On the other side of things, Desonite pushing into the spawn, unable to get the elimination, but this is where his teammate can't get the revive either. Down on Desonite, but that's where it stops. The Pittsburgh Knights' aggression is just seemingly too much in map number two for this Rebel squad. I haven't seen anything so far that convinced me that they're awake and ready.
Mm-hmm. All righty. Now, going into this round, PK, they got off hot. They got off to a hot start with these first two rounds. And it's looking like we are going to get another utility grenade, loadout utility for the front spawn. And does Rebel want to match this now, or do they want to change the pace of this fight off the start? And these first two rounds have been pretty close, okay? I feel like they've been close enough for Rebel not to panic just yet on what they're placing, but they will choose to get some extra smoke grenades. Now, these smoke grenades can play a huge part into this round, especially if Rebel loses the initial fight at control tower. Smoke off those lanes, force PK to have to rotate out. We're seeing a 2-2-1 between both these squads. Crack and Identis at the apex of the fight. Crack misses two rap shots, but he does not miss the third. The revive comes through. Dezo with the down. Keeping the pressure here forces Crack to backpack his teammate. That's how much pressure Desonite was applying. He says, I'm going to get a kill regardless, even if I'm not the one killing the guy. Now, down low, Rebel needs to be able to get some support to help their teammate out in Adverse to get this B hill capped up, because they're going to be able to get this B, but do they want to turn around and fight for the home hill, or do they get out and set up? Looks like they're going to retreat and force PK and try to defend our home hill so PK does not overextend for too much. But they need not overextend too much, Jacob, because PK might try to fake him out and cut back to B.
I don't like that at all. Summons was just getting on the field, just trying to get in position. Identitives bites off more than he can chew. You see the rotation coming through. Dez and I just pressing that button, making one less passageway for everybody to go through, but Crack going in, getting it down on Raver, taking out Summons as he chose to revive. This is where Crack just waiting for that perfect moment to strike, but he waited a little bit too long. Raver taking full advantage and even trying to go ahead and distract this Rebel army, pushing through. They're trying to get the triple cap domination. Rebel, or Raver, I should say, does not get any eliminations. Identity is quick to fall afterwards, so PK is just getting tossed on their side. Monkey's forced all the way back into spawn. He said, forget this, I give up.
He says, nope.
You missed
not giving you guys
one.
Any free points, all right? Hell, Monkey is trying to protect his MVP. Ballot there for the rest of the season here with his stats, you know, so he can't have anybody else closing a gap on him. Now, when placements go down, Rebel has quickly built up that Marksa, and this is where PK is going to use those utility grenades to put down that torque bow. And if you ask me, I think that is a great sacrifice for not having an extra front spawn loadout for your squad. Rebel is just going to have to make good use of that Marksa, and it's going to be in the hands of Cardia, and we know he can put it to great.
I want to see him just angle it up top. I know that's kind of what he's going to be looking to do, but he needs to be careful for his man down low. First down going over to Adver. He's got to know the revive's coming through. PK smoked out. Players getting taken out left and right. A little bit of a trade towards up top. Identimus lands a big shot on Adverse. Quickly turns, trying to go for Crack. Reaction shot coming out from Crack. And that's going to be a big play opportunity. Summons at least is trying to burn that torque. But make sure, hey, if I don't get it, neither are you guys. Trying to run away. And I like the way he's marked. He's trying to bait a kill for Monkeys. He's going to stay and try and fight. But him and Monkeys have met their match. They're actually going to get crossed out. That is the spawn side of Rebel. They just had to look through it. And even Summons gets taken down. So the torque bow is now out of play. Adverse with a huge double kill. So Rebel, once again, after losing the first two rounds, are bouncing back.
Adverse wants blood. He has not stopped shooting. Picked up two kills. Last member standing is Identis on top of the home hill. Now his teammates have respawned and they're behind him. But PK has to go forward. Push Rebel back. They're going to acquire the kills at the same time. Rebel, indecisive, the flank came through, reflame, Crack, they pick up three. There's so much chaos on the minimap, Adverse is gonna finally get out. He says, I'm gonna live to fight again. Number seven goes for the trip cap. Mr. Krabs,
he gets the chuck away from the hill.
Oh, great effort. No cigar. PK, they survive for now.
I don't know what Adverse did right there. Hey, he was long gone. You weren't trying to save your teammate. You were possibly just trying to get a cheeky kill. Even if you get the kill, you still die all the same. So a little bit of a blunder on the side of Adverse as the best members of PK are getting taken out. Crack does it again. Anytime there's a big play, Crack or Demon seem to step up to the plate.
He
sends that body
into
the other atmosphere right now as someone's doing all he can for the Knights. But it's just not enough. Every single time I see the Knights trying to push up in this round, they're immediately met with a group of Lancers and just shut down.
Man, based off the amount of action in which we've had, I feel like I'm casting a Gears 4 throwback on it, but these players don't have too many respawns remaining. Summons, Identis, they have zero. Multiple players are one on the side of Rebel now. For PK, they got two heals to their name, but they need more than that. Desonite, he's on his last respawn now. Summons, what can you do? This is a big fight for your team, and he's going to be able to capitalize and pick that one up. Now he needs to get to the home hill. He can't stop. Raver's gonna win his fight as well. So it's a great start for PK to get the C hill. They got B locked in already. Uh-oh, Rebels get a little bit flustered. They're gonna fortify on top of their home hill. But PK, they know exactly where the remaining few players are. They get the decap on C. Looking to close it out now. Does Rebel have what it takes? Two pimmers of PK can't spawn in. This is a 2v5. A 4 PK to win this round, and that's going to be all she wrote here in the first half. We're all tied up 2-2.
That's how you build momentum back onto your side if you're Rebel. You go in, you just completely stagger the deaths. And usually that's going to be one of the big keys to victories, no matter who you're going up against. Make sure that they're never up as five. Even if that means kind of leave them on the ground, let them kill themselves even in some of these moments. But big chunks going around left and right. And you saw it there. Blaze even said it. Two members of the Pittsburgh Knights were out of lives due to short respawns and the amount of action that was on the field. So luckily for Rebel, they had identives number and summons throughout the course of that round. But you see the weapon selection, torque boat towards up top, smokes on the side, utilities all around into loadouts, and then that lone Marksa on the side of Rebel. So far, I haven't seen it put to too much use, but great stop from Knights to let that torque boat go down on their side.
All right, now. Oh, PK sitting four up top. They need to react quickly. Now Rebel has a right hand, and Crack is going forward, playing off his teammate's nades perfectly. They get behind enemy lines, but nobody's there for the cleanup. PK still surviving with all four members of life. Now, I take that back. Raver did die in that initial engagement, but the trip cap domination is coming through. Rebel, do they make the 200 IQ play? They do.
Wow, immediately catching that one slipping. I want to know who played middle for Rebel. That had to be the key player. They had the key piece of information.
It was,
because, Blade, you saw it through the overhead
zero,
map.
I think. Yeah, zero. Whoever zero is.
Through the overhead map, you saw it. The Pittsburgh Knights, they sent four players immediately up top. Didn't waste no time. They wanted to win this big power weapon up top. That player in the middle, you said it was zero, saw that one coming, literally went from home hill to home hill downtown to get that capture to force that play. So if you're the Pittsburgh Knights, you send four people up top, you have to win that fight. You have to win it convincingly as well. It was just two players towards the low side that got that triple cap domination.
Man, Crack. I don't know if you should be able to get the numbers call out as you're rotating through mid-map, how many players are going up there. Now, I don't know if he saw it off the start, his teammate Gatterform, but he charged into PK, played off his nades, and he's charging again for the back lines, and I love the play. Cleans him up, put PK in a difficult spot. He ran past three, but his teammates need to be able to clean up the two that had to turn their back to find him. But ultimately, Designite and Identis, though, sorry, Identis and summons were able to hold composure, get the power weapon, and now PK has a 2-1 heal advantage.
Now it's their turn to try to bring this one back. You see Identims with the torque bow. He can easily make short work of this guy right in front of him, but the teammate's spawning up. That's going to be Demon trying to be the reinforcements that they need. But as soon as Demon commits over to that side of things, he can go for splash damage on Crack. Quick shoddy shot to try to take him out, especially with Designite over there with the cross. I do believe that's the play they're trying to cook up, but Crack probably seeing it coming as well. Hearing that torque bow reload, he gets out of dodge, living fight another day.
Now Rebel on their back foot. They're going to be able to send four players quickly down low to E. They're playing for kills before they want to decap the hills, but Monkeys played it very well on his defensive back foot to be able to get those kills, and now putting out damage. Rebel knows that this fight ain't it. They might not be able to come out on top with this victory. PK got them exactly where they want. They're gonna get this one all tied up 3-3. And great round for PK there. After they won the initial, they didn't give up anything else. They had all three lanes locked in. They knew Rebel was gonna make a push somewhere on the map. Now, the push that Rebel brought out was great because they ran past the hill. They were almost able to isolate two players and have a 4v2 in numbers, but Monkeys slowed him down, and a rotation came through from mid-map with his reinforcements to be able to lock that round in with PK.
Talk about the reinforcements around the map. You already see the difference in strategies. That Marksa placement really nullified having that Ensign directly into the fight. But I will say, it doesn't make it too much of a disadvantage as long as this player in Reflame is able to use it in the 1v1 scenario down towards the low side, because you see all the players rotating middle, putting their resources up top. That torque bow is going to be a big part of it. I get him. Catches Crack slipping, gets him with the misroll, and instant separating them. So a free torque bow grab for the King of Latin America, and immediately charging up, scaring that player in Reflame only. If I do believe that's Raver down there, could take advantage of this angle. Oh my god, he hit that torque bow, Blaze.
What a shot. What a shot. Identis did a great job taking out Crack off the initial to get this bow, and he's gonna stick another. But he goes down. Demon goes down. Identis will be saved. And he got two more Torque Bows to work around. Jacob, off that initial, I was so curious if Crack was going to switch it up or run at PK again, because their flash placements were perfect. But that time around, Identis was waiting for him. He had to switch it up with his right hand there and possibly force PK to play to him rather than staying aggressive there. But we'll see if he can bring some aggression out now, because this team is going to need it to break up this defensive setup that PK got. Now, they were able to take out the Torque Bow, but can it get to E and can it get to F in time?
I don't know. It just seems like Rebel right now, at least some individuals time and time are making some desperation plays, but the rest of the squad going in, getting that capture. Great button plus, so they're actually only going to get the decap out of it. But this is where I like that player in Demon pressing forward, knowing he's not going to get this capture. Tries to push the enemy team back from the Knights, and he's going to do just that. And that's where the rest of his team is going to go ahead and try to catch up, get the cap that he fought so hard for the positioning for, and go ahead and try to escape. Two players actually did get downed out. Rotation's wow. coming through. Guardia has to make a big play. One chunk coming through. Revive's gonna happen, so it's only a trade between that big double down. Great revive from Cardia, and you don't really harm or give credit to a revive, but just in the nick of time, this could have been Knights dominating the rest of the round, pressing forward for more.
Now, the Knights, they're gonna slow it down just a bit here. You don't want to play for too much. They already got an F and E and a slight lead. Torque Bow is gonna be up momentarily, and I think that's what Rebel's gonna be grouping up for on those side stairs. PK's bringing reinforcements up. They already have it in their hand. Now, with four bows left, Summons goes from downtown to possibly get a stick, but he's going to try to play for the splash damage. It's a nice button press, guaranteeing more points for PK. And even, oh, the flank comes through, the quick turnaround. He says, what? What? That's all you got?
You win the round.
Gonna stop playing.
I'm gonna say, if you win the round, that disrespect is worth it. That disrespect is worth it, but only if you win the round. Here comes Reflame, trying to make a hero play. Nobody's in position. You look at his teammates, they're just kind of conceding this one away. This is the second half. Those lives are so important, especially since the Pittsburgh Knights have a 1-0 map lead. And honestly, I need to see a replay of that one, Blaze. That was just a nasty turnaround.
He heard the shot to his right. He turns around and he chunks him. Didn't see that other guy. He was like, okay, miss. That's why he's always strafing, just in case. He's never standing still. He's like, all right, just, you know, stay moving. You never know when somebody may be on your flank.
I like the way you said that. Always moving, always strafing back and forth. Never an easy target. There's not even a sniper on the map right now, and he kind of keeps that intact into his gameplay. It helps so much. That honestly turns like an 85 brick into like a 60% shot. It turns a chunk into somebody kind of escaping narrowly. It really makes all the difference in the world, and there's a prime position right there, right in front of us.
Ow. Here we go. Drop shot is on the map. This fight is going to change a bit. It's going to be a 1v1 up top, 3v3 in the middle for drop. But pretty much the way this fight's breaking down, center line, all players are a part of this one. But can Identis get his team a height advantage if he wins this fight against Demon? Drop shot's not acquired by anybody just yet. It's a stalemate. But Torque Bow's picked up. Demon runs away. He drops one on the ground to possibly take out Identis. Damaged him a bit, but now Identis will take out the Torque Bow. He gets an angle. PK knows that they can press forward because they already got Identis in position to cause some commotion. He dies, but even with that death, his life was not in vain as PK picks up the drop shot, and now they're going to drop back into their setup.
Instantaneous from Monkeys. As soon as Desenide went down, he realized he was not going to get over in time to get that revive. That drop shot was his next best play, and it worked out for him. But on the other side of things, Raver gets caught all by himself on this neutral. He is going to get taken out. Luckily for the Knights, they have just under a 50-plus point lead, so they're able to kind of backtrack, slow it down just a little bit, figure out where the numbers are, and put a stop to this push. Because you look at the overhead map, Rebel wants to end this round. They want to force another round number 9 as Cardia goes around the back. Demon trying to get a kill. Cardia's going to be the only one taken out. Multiple members of PK are going down. Summons a Raver. They have to beat the heroes that is needed, but Raver sneaks around.
It's coming down to the home hill. It's a 2v1 for Rebel at E. Surely they win that with the flank. They need one of these guys on top of D instead. Too many of their resources are down low, and that's going to give PK an opportunity to fight their way out of this one. But Demon if he makes a big play, he will not, because Iditzis has turned up. Look at it in this series now.
All hail the king of Latin America, Iditzis, consistently being a big part of the offense and the defense of this squad. It doesn't really matter who he has surrounded around him. He is an MVP-style player, and he brings out the best. Unfortunately, he does get angled out, taken out by the members of Rebel. Cardia takes a ton of damage, but there's nobody on the Night Squad able to solidify this down. It's actually them being pushed back. Summits up towards topside. Using that elevation, he has the button pressed. So even though this is going to be a hard-fought battle, even if Rebel somehow wins it, that button will be pressed, but Summons risks his life to press the button, gets taken out by Demon. Now the Torpo will be in the hands of Rebel.
You're going to have to make some great plays with this one. Monkey's trying to get a decap. He's going to fall. Now, the positioning of this Torpo is everything. Uh-oh. He's going to be able to catch Iditzis. Taking some shots from his right, needs to play his life as he's trying to go for the decap. Nice placement on the ground to force Desonite out of cover. His teammate cleans up the kill. Reflame doubles back for the capture. And with two heals to their name, the Swarm team now has the win condition. Monkeys, what do you do here? How do you bring your team back into the game? Three members in front of you. He has them all hurt. Can he get one? He cannot. We're going to another round, number 9.
We got the disrespect coming out from someone on Rebel. Humping Monkeys, really showing him who's boss, but it's all tied up 4-4. Deja vu, we see the round number 9 in map number 1, and we get the treat of a round number 9 again. You got the Torpo topside, drop shot in the middle, and instantly a lockdown of those instant grenades. So it's going to be Rebel saying no more to one of the biggest threats on your side of the map. So it doesn't really matter what gets locked down on the side of Rebel. They'll either have a Marksa or an Ensign to their advantage.
Rebel definitely won the battle of weapon placements to me.
Ooh, what?
Ha! BK. They put a sniper down low and incinerator. They know they're going to be fighting a 1v1. Now, this is a round 9, and we have lost one soldier. We got to wait for Rebel, for Raver to get back into this game. Whew. It gives us a time to take a breather. Okay, it's a lot that has happened in these last... Hell, ever since round number 4, it's been nothing but chaotic fights.
Wait a minute.
Left and right between these two squads.
I need to see who was placing that weapon down.
It was a PK placement.
No, but like who in particular was placing that weapon down? Because you could vote on it as a team, but if Raver was the one that lagged out, and if he was the one controlling the weapon placement, then his team kind of had to force. They had no choice to put that sniper down. So they could have wanted a block. So this lag out, being forced to put that sniper, I kind of need that full story. My head is thinking on 6 different levels right now, because if Raber is the one that lagged out, he cannot choose where that weapon placement goes. I'm watching the replay on stream right now. That weapon placement did not move. So PK had no choice but to put that sniper down centerline on a round number 9. That is huge. I had a feeling it was a mistake.
Yeah, and it could be a mistake because we've never seen nothing like that before go down on this map. But it's here, and it's officially in play. So now we just got to talk about how is it going to change this team fight. And I don't think much is going to change as far as how we saw the allocation of players between both these squads. We're going to get a 1v1 up top. We're going to get 3 players going to middle for the drop shot. And we're going to get a 1v1 down low. Now, Rebel, they got an incendiary grenade in that 1v1 that they can take towards that sniper and play for it immediately if they want to. What PK may need to do with that weapon being in the map and is possibly cut 2 players from middle, okay? Because that incendiary grenade is getting picked up by Rebel, and they're sending 4 players towards the opposite side. So the player who's playing E, if he just wants to beeline it to cut in the middle for a flank possibly, that could give PK the leg up in which they need. From that point on, you got to just stop the snipe pickup. You know, you can easily press the button to do that, but PK needs to avoid that incendiary grenade because Rebel is going to try to make a game-winning play off of it at some point on the initial in this round. And there's plenty of power weapons on the map for everybody to get something. You know, everybody has a weapon to fight for. I do believe that this will slow down after the first initial team fight if it's not won on that one.
it's funny you talk about everybody has a kind of a weapon to fight for. I look at the utility in these guys. Almost everybody has the utility to kind of use to their advantage. So Shades of Gears of War 4 almost right back at you, where you have that stun, you have that bit of utility. Go ahead and use both of these guys. You see Raver without one on the other side. It's Reflame without an extra utility grenade in their hand. So this is going to get interesting to see how it does play out, because depending on who maneuvers over for Rebel to grab that instant grenade that is still up, it might be a player that already has utility. So unless Reflame is going ahead and trying to pick up that instant grenade, they're going to have to sacrifice that flash or smoke, whatever it may be, to pick up that incense. So there's no extra bit of utility on the side of Rebel just yet. But as the course of this round does play out, that's when they'll have that extra incense that does spawn up.
Alrighty then. Man, they're going to get themselves in a right position. Get into their pictagon, their pentagon formation here. Because, you know, where they leave out of spawn is everything. You kind of to the far to the right, Raver. You better scoot on over. Gotta scooch over. Okay,
that's what you get for lagging out.
They gotta get him on his right response. You know, get him back to whatever number he had before. Now it's probably 3 out of 4. Spawn him right off there to the end. Identus, you know, you can slide back a bit, maybe an inch and a half, you know, maybe behind monkeys. This is a weird ass pentagon I'm looking at. Whoa.
He's just checking. He's just checking right now, Blaze. He's just checking across. You guys, you guys is probably just got to go ahead and check.
Bring. I'm back. Yeah, there you go.
Lancer is that he has out right now, though? That's a really colorful lancer.
Yeah. Good job to the observers, keeping them accountable. Okay, they peek over at the stream and say, hey, they're watching us. Hold up.
That's Meerkat's good job. You got to make sure you spot out who is moving.
Keep the mini map up. This is perfect.
2 centimeters to the left. 2 centimeters to the left. Oh, here we go.
This is
playing out.
That flank from number two, you guys. It may come. He was gonna get to that incinerator first anyway. Oh, he goes through. Raver versus Reflame.
Oh.
He goes down. Torque bolt being picked up here by Crack. He's looking to check down, see who he can find. PK having to scurry backwards towards their home hill. Drop shot. It's going to be in the hands of Summons. That was the play. It was the quick pick that came through. Cardia with the mark. So that's a headshot from downtown. PK is trying their hardest to slow this one down. Number five did make it up top. That's going to be Designized. So he was able to get some map control for his team, but number six won't let him get there. He's keeping a lancer to isolate Designized as he gets taken out. PK needs to use his drop shot now to get out of this difficult spot. They need to start making some plays.
Getting taken out left and right. Summons, he was down at one point, so teammates doing all they can to go ahead and save him. He picks up a huge drop shot kill, gets the team down kill on Demon as well, which kind of led to that team kill you just spoke about. So huge plays by Summon, even has an extra drop shot in the hands, but Reflame, that sniper that was placed by the Knights, is now in the hands of Reflame. Ooh. Hits a body shot, that's gonna be some big damage. Drop shot over the top, unable to connect, just hit the flip of that cover. Now we're gonna see Reflame
right in the middle.
Swap over with Demon. I haven't really seen Demon execute with the Cypher before. I haven't seen him in general with the Cypher before.
He's got the lineup.
One of my first chances.
He's aiming for covers. Players may slide to where they may be at. Ooh! Takes out Summons. Now Rebel is able to push through E, lock down that area, but they know they need to defend their home hill because PK has the entire other side of the map in their control for the most part. Now, PK is isolated in several different areas.
Oh.
Designite's out of position once again, but he may be a little bit sneaky. He's currently fighting a 2v2 fight with his teammate Raver, and they should be able to get towards their opponent's home hill if they choose to. But the one kill they got is keeping their teammates in position. But that's a double down at Electric. Revives need to come through now. Summons got two. Designite gets the third. 3 members down for Rebel. Adverse is out of here. PK looking to end this series. They didn't get off to a hot start in round number 9, but they can close it out here, but it's not over yet, Jacob.
And they just need to be very, very careful. Adverse, adios, amigo. You're out of the game. 4v5 is going to go ahead and continue. But with a drop shot in the hands of Demon, you have 2 players with no extra respawns remaining. You need to be on target. You let that one loose. You fail, but a revive comes through. You get blessed with a second chance. Monkeys gets taken out with the torque bow. Drop shot going to take out Summons. A 4v4 is going
to continue. No more respawns on PK.
Any fans of 4v4, now's your chance to get a treat.
This is a close one. We're pretty much all tied up here, folks. As E-Hill is getting decapped, Rebel's gonna acquire it. 1 torque bow remaining. Oh. He sticks him through the ground. now pressing up for the decap. Raver has to make some big plays, utilizing that Lancer to keep the hill cap. This team cannot afford to give up any more points, but reinforcements fly through. He's out of here. Folks, we're going to a map number 3.
Just insane plays after plays after plays. 4-3 lead for the Pittsburgh Knights. Got squandered. 5-4. Rebels bring it back. They force a map number 3, Blaze. And did you think this one was coming?
I did not see this one coming wholeheartedly. I knew it was going to be a close series, but I'm not surprised whatsoever because it could have been 2 round 9. Well, we did get 2 round 9s, but Rebel, they edged them out here in map number 2. We are going the distance, folks. Don't go anywhere. When we come back, we got the epic conclusion of this series between the Pittsburgh Knights versus Rebel.
Has been an exciting. It's definitely kept me on my toes, and I usually like to think I can guess a lot of what goes down, but this is why we always
can't predict this one
down. Yeah, you can't predict some of these matches. And finally, I'm gonna go ahead and say it. I know Colin's been asking for it. We got summons in a Pittsburgh Knights jersey.
About time, because it's been a long time. All right, I know he has had 1,000 photos in that jersey. Shout out for management for sending that one on over, so he can look good with his team at the top. You know, next is UIU, because they got 3 different jerseys on theirs. But back into this series, as we see the aggression from Rebel popping up into the info of PK, looking to wipe out Dezo. Now, he did get taken out, but not before taking one to the grave. Reflame trying to stay alive, but he can't stay alive for too long. PK, they lock into B Hill. They successfully defend their home hill from a flank. And now they're waiting for the next move Rebel wants to make.
He's trying to maneuver around. He gets kind of caught out of positioning. He couldn't continue to go across. There was enough damage. He had to cut around the corner. Unfortunately for him, they were able to catch up to him in no time. Due to the long respawn times, both players, Raver, and I do believe Desnite, are going to be able to go from home hill to home hill, trying to threaten what Rebel has under their control. The only hill under their control. Down's coming through. Cardia down. Demon Adverse gets taken out as well. Flank coming through from Identives. And I love what he's doing right here. He's just putting the damage out, and he's not giving up any free kills. Lancer is going to be strong. Players just getting chunked out. I would say triple cap domination, but win by elimination is going to come through. It's actually a domination. I would rather that be a win by elimination, but just a second short for that one to come out. Nonetheless, the Knights showing up strong in round number 1, almost serving up donuts to the other team. Somebody got a french fry.
Oh, you know, well, the rest of them are all glazed up here by the Knights. As we head here in round number 2, PK seems like it seems like PK wanted to make a statement here in this map. They're like, you know what? This is too close. This is not good for our ego going this close, toe to toe against Rebel. And off rip, Rebel chooses to put the drop shot up top. Oh man, this is going to be a good one. And now, you know, it's all coming back to me. My series last week where I watched PK play, I want to say these are the exact same maps that they played against Fire and Ice. Okay, and because, you know, this fight right here, PK handed in the second half after being down against FNI, and this was the fight that brought them back in it. Now, Rebel looks like they're going to say that we're not Fire and Ice, okay? We're nowhere close to being that squad. We're going to come out here, have a better engagement off this initial. Demon's going to hold the drop, but he's trying to stay alive. Teammates can't get to him in time, and ultimately, PK will kill all members remaining in the cinema, and no more drop shots in play as well.
Now, and I like the strategy to come through. District, you kind of see different elements on the map. A lot of heavy pushes home to home. You see a lot of Lancers set up with juice. But just like the difference between Vaskar and Forge, to where both maps are kind of rotation maps, but one map is a little bit more straightforward in Forge. You see Rebel was able to take that one. They're trying to turn this map to play just like that, straightforward with that drop shot, knowing where the enemy team is going to be positioned almost at all times of the game. Unfortunately, it was looking good at the start, but it did not end so well on that initial. So they're kind of funneling around, trying to look for positioning. They're not able to get together as a single 5-man squad just yet. Cracks on respawn. Dez and I doing a good job of lancering these players out. Demon's going to be left all by himself. He actually reunites with Adverse, but there goes the brick wall, which is the Pittsburgh Knights defense. They're striking again. Anything Rebel has is being answered straight up by the Knights.
Yeah, PK is just trying to set a statement here, and I think they're doing a good job at it. They've got the mission locked in. Now, PK, they're looking to get the trip cap domination on top of this hill. And with that down, they have the right to sit here. Also, they're going to have Raver in their opponent's info, so that means that nobody can shoot down off the sides of them. But PK will still choose to disengage because they know that it's not the perfect play to go for the trip cap domination. They could have possibly made it happen, but they know that this has been a close series, and Rebel has been playing them tight, so they don't want to give them too much here. Now they're looking to push towards the home hill, and this time around, they should have no problems getting it. We end by way of elimination.
2-2 is what my prediction going into the half would be. Two rounds in a row to start off each of these three maps went over to the Knights. And if we see any bit of deja vu, if history will repeat itself, Rebel tends to win the next two rounds, tying up 2-2 into the half. So will history continue, or will either one of these teams slip up and let something slip by? But you see PK, instead of placing that flash grenade topside, which eventually upgrades to a shock, they're making sure that their top slayers, the people playing their front spawns, have that utility directly into their hands and worry about that shock grenade a little later.
All right, here we go, here we go. Now, both squads making sure that they got enough utility for this fight. Now, Rebel didn't have that front spawn utility last round, but they still made good use of getting that drop shot early on. Identus, he's going to dart in, having a backup just a bit, fire some shots through the smokes, not getting hit markers. A little bit worried, but he knows that's a great opportunity to pick up the drop. He picks one up, grabs two. Now, PK with a one-man advantage, looking to survive this flank from Crack. He gets it down, but has no help. PK, get the drop shot. Now they'll be able to set up his demon, just trying to play his life and buy time for his teammates to come off respawn.
Not enough time. Teammates coming through. Rotating downward. They need to make sure they at least start getting some point gain because it's the Pittsburgh Knights that have two hills under their control. So you see the difference already. It's going to be a Rebel going down low, trying to get control bandstand and the center of the map. But Guardian needs to be careful. He gets caught out of position. There's two members from the Knights waiting for that moment to strike. One of them is going to be Monkeys, but Identives from across the juice going to take out Crack. And this is where I begin to wonder, why would you go ahead and waste that for just a singular kill? You can easily turn around, try to use this down low, two drop shots to nullify these three players pushing over. Unfortunately for them, that does not happen. Demon able to get that first one on Raver. The push is going to continue. They got the decap, which is going to be step number one. Someone's actually getting pushed back as well. The short respawn timers means if they choose to turn around at the right moment, they will be faced with those same people they eliminated. So already a good job for Rebel fighting back into this one. All the hills being decapped. Triple cap domination sounding off for a moment. Raver needs to find a hill. I don't think he is, but Monkeys, MVP on the other side of the map, is going to continue this round.
I love how Monkeys waits for the very last minute to step into that hill, making Rebel feel like they got the victory locked in. So EK, they come off respawn. That may have even flustered Rebel just a bit. Number six is chasing down two, and Adverse gets taken out here, so Identis will be able to set his team up to get the B hill back. And that's a good job to Monkeys to keep his team alive in this round, being sneaky, getting behind enemy lines. And Identis, two clean back A's from him. He's going to go into spawn, knows exactly where Cardi is, but he returns the favor off one from the left hand. And now, can he get two of his own? PK is going to survive. They're going to just stay alive, slow down, wait for Identis to respawn. They know that they have done enough in this round so far based off how it started.
Especially since Dez and I does have that drop shot, so they can continue to play aggressive if they want, but they just need to play perfect here. Dez and I going ahead avenging that kill on summons. Nobody slipping by just yet for Rebel. Two hills still in favor of the Knights. They're now going to not only tie it up, but gain the lead. Drop shot, headshot. Dez and I with his head on swivel takes out Adverse next.
What?
Win by elimination in a blink of an eye, 3-0. Just complete domination from the Pittsburgh Knights. I said this was not going to go round number 9, but I didn't think it would go 3-0 to start it off.
Man, so PK in that realm, man. I thought Rebel was going to be able to fight hard. They fought hard, but I thought they were going to be able to survive it for just a second. And they just let Monkeys get behind them. They lost track of them, right? And that's where it comes down to making sure all three lanes are covered as your plan for the trip cap dominations. If you got your teammates in front of you, take a second to look back and say, hit LB and turn, make, you know, pan out and say, is anybody behind me covering this side of the map? Because it looks pretty open. But we'll see how it starts off the initial this time around. Multiple flashes and smokes on top of the hill. Reflame with the quick pick, but PK pushing the outskirts of the hill, trying to catch Reflame off guard as he's rotating back, and they do get him. They pick up a few kills in transition as well. Four down, last member on the home hill. They got a drop shot to deal with him really soon, but with it being the lowest respawn rounds of the half, PK will play for a trip cap domination. Number seven is making sure nobody can get out of spawn. Six and eight, blocking info. They're forcing Rebel down low into these drop shots, but will the trap work? Will it be set? Rebel, they're trying to fight their way out of it, Jacob.
Giving them false hope, almost even. You see, as soon as they gave up their home hill, Rebel tried to push forward, and players getting eliminated left and right. I talk about that false hope yet again. It's in Identiv's hands. He's waiting for that perfect moment when they go in to try to get the decap, possibly eliminations as well. In comes the drop shot, so they need to be very, very careful. Cardia misrolls. I almost think that's misroll saved his life.
Yo, I learned this from Violet. He can hit shots there. Okay, like Violet posted some content. You know, map packs for District. And she pinpointed that angle. So if you guys don't give Violet content a follow, check her out. Great tips and tricks for Gears of War. But PK, drop shot in hand, active in the chamber. Now, A hill's locked in. They're going to give up B. They're going to go look to play for the home hill down low. So we see how Rebel has it defended from the mini map. Number two is going to have a big job when it comes down to slowing down PK.
Uh-oh, audio summons. But honestly, I think PK could still close this one out. They have the drop shot. They just need to start making Wolfpack plays. Dezenai needs to make sure he doesn't get caught out of position. He will always be by himself on the other side of the map. You see the drop shot from up top. Adverse gets taken down. Talk about Dezenai being all by his lonesome. He gets caught out. Drop shot going to connect with Crack. But they need more than just that one hill. They need to continue on as Identiv tries to make his way towards that neutral. And this is where it is going to be big for them. Demon gets that drop shot as well. They know Raver is cutting through. He is spotted out. Do they see Identiv? I don't know. But a big shot being landed. They remember, they do have that Raver drop shot. And Crack is out of the game.
Raver got behind. Crack's out too. This is so winnable for PK. Edwards. Even without Dezenai here, they can get this one done with two hills to their name. Dezenai is going to be alive up top. PK, no one's at the bottom portion of the map. Monkeys is just playing gatekeeper at his opponent's home hill. Looking for a fight. He's going to find one soon as multiple players have to rotate down low. PK is going to shift down to make sure they can defend. Demon, he has to go big with this drop shot. It is a 4v3 in favor of PK. But with that drop shot coming through, it buys Rebel a little bit of time, Jacob.
The kill you want. That's that kill on Raver that you want. It's 3v4.
2v2.
Actually, 2v2? Right on the home hill. He gets taken out. The only member alive right now is Cardia. He still has the lead, but he needs to make sure his hills don't get decapped. And just as soon as that neutral hill does, the win condition does switch over. Barring a miracle world star play, I was about to say, Cardia will get
taken out. They don't need summons. They don't need them. They say, we worked hard enough in rounds 1, 2, and 3 to the point where we don't need them, okay?
In that last round, they worked so hard. They got the drop shot in Identiv's hands. They made the perfect rotations when being down a man, and they were able to spot out these players that had no respawns and take them out, which forced a 3v4 scenario for some of that round.
Oh, man, so hey, if it's a round for anyone to lag out, we know it very well. It's got to be that one, right? It's got to be the last round and a half. Your team has a lead here. It worked out, but you know, and the reason. So just to kind of break it down just a bit more, another big reason why kind of PK took it. Everybody was in respawn watch on the side of Rebel. All right, they were in respawn warnings. PK still had two drop shots to use, and they did a good job at forcing these fights. Also, Raver, man, he was flanking through his opponent's spawn to catch up with Identiv. He was able to distract multiple players for a while for his teammates to be able to isolate some 1v1s elsewhere on the map. Big team effort across the board. And I said PK was going to make a statement on this map. They've made one. Rebel, they got to bounce back, but it's going to be hard, very hard.
That shot grenade get placed towards the backside. No, it did not. So Reflame's going to get that drop shot and get out alive, puts it to use, takes out Dezenai as well, wasting no time. Another one from downtown, he gets damage, Is anybody going to be able to clean it up? No, they are not. And he doesn't have a shotgun, so he can't push forward all by himself. Summon sees that one coming, reads it from a mile away, knowing that he has no shotgun. Completely takes a bit. Oh, my God, Blaze. I would have had a heart attack right now.
He had the timing right, but it just did not work out. Now, once the dust has settled, this kill will get cleaned up down low for Rebel. They don't have their home hill just yet, but Reflame will get the capture there. Now Rebel are going to be able to just put themselves in some nooks and cubbies down low around the E-Hill, wait for the drop shot respawn up top. But that's going to be a while till the end. They're trying to set themselves up for plays that PK could be making through the middle, down low at E, maybe home hill to home hill. We'll find out soon.
Honestly, they lose this round, there's no sweat on their brow. Pixar Knights with a 4-0 commanding lead. Rebel is going to have to chain together five near-perfect rounds to come out on top. And Demon already gets caught out. He gets caught out in the juice of all places, Blaze. There's no reason why juice-to-juice combat you should go down. Riding off more than you can chew usually is the case in that scenario. We should see Reflame all by himself. Possible chunk shot in the back as Monkeys takes out Reflame, and they're down left and right. All five members from Rebel at one point or another were eliminated off the map. No triple cap domination sounding off just yet, but Demon, he needs to buy his team some time. He needs to get a reset on this.
PK pushes through the juice and they get the squeeze on Rebel, and they're gonna lock this series in. 5-0 victory in map number 3. It was an epic series, but this final map, PK really took it to another level that Rebel was not ready for. They remain undefeated in the Pro League.
Yep, and you see Identive 16-3-7 kind of leading way for his team a couple maps here today. And that's going to be a big win for the Knights because, like you said, they're going to remain undefeated. They're going to be 6-0. And this is where I begin to start to think, try to have the schedule in front of me, trying to see who they play up against. They play against Noble, the People's Champ, Rise, Vanquish, and Apricity. So they have a decent schedule ahead of them. I don't think too many of those guys can really take them on. So there is a real possibility that the Pittsburgh Knights go undefeated throughout Season 2 of the Gears Pro League.
They have played some of their hardest matchups. Hell, they had UYU in week number 1, okay? Especially in this round, Robin. So they was able to get over that hump. They've already played Rise. Did you say that right?
Rise? They play Rise coming up.
Okay, so that's the big matchup. I think that's probably one of the only teams that I feel like that can possibly give them an L in that category. But regardless of the fact, PK has been playing phenomenal up until this point. And, you know, we still get a chance to get that Vanquish versus PK series as well. Now, Vanquish got their first loss, but they can still get first place if they take out PK. So their fate is in their hands. That's going to be a big one. VQ, they played PK a few times in E days, and so they're going to be prepared for them. It's going to be a banger. But enough on that one, man. You know, we see in this series here the PK District montage. You know, this was the 4v5 round right there a little bit. Big drop shot kills. Big kills across the board. PK 2-1 here. And, that was just our third series of the day, folks. We still got one more coming up here soon.
Yep, we got a big one coming up. What'd you say? It's Hive versus Noble. And I do believe we're going to have the full Noble squad back in action here. They've been playing with a couple of subs. So this is a chance for a Box to get his feet wet again and really show the type of player he is. You said he might have missed me a few weeks, but now is the time. So with that coming up next, you guys know Noble versus Hive. Don't go anywhere because we're going to be right back.